And thanks for the kind introduction, and thanks to all for being here. So the purpose of my talk today will be to show you a very agnostic way to actually analyze some CytPix data that we followed. And to be very honest, we had the instrument like 2 weeks. So what you're going to see is a snapshot of what we could do along that time. But just first, so that you understand a bit better what we do, the Center of Immunophenomics in Marseille, you know, okay. We are interested in studying the immune system and the immune reaction, and it's very complicated. You have lots of interactors. So for that, that's why we actually use intensively cytometry in the lab. And not only this, it's a bit like Juan. So we try to combine instrumentation, high-end panels, bioinformatics, as well as mouse models. I'm working mostly in the preclinical space. And the idea is that we can help our partners to identify a cellular correlate to a candidate treatment. So that's what we do every day. So most of the data, scientific data, actually my partners' data, so I cannot obviously show them today. That's why the talk is going to be very technical. That's the profile of instrument we have in the lab. So as you see, it's quite quite rich. And you could question why you know, we are starting to be interested in the CytPix. And obviously, hopefully, at the end of my talk, you will understand why we really deeply want to have this instrument. So I told you we have lots of panels, so we can profile the whole mouse immune system in different organs. And this process actually took some time. So now I've seen it's like 10 years we have the YouTube now. So it's been a long, long story together. And once you have this panel, what you want to do is just perturb the immune system, right? You want to change the basal status and then see how the immune response reacts to the challenge. And currently, so we can do inflammation, but currently we do more and more immuno-oncology pipeline. And with more translational things like patient-derived xenograft. And this is actually a real challenge because it's kind of each tumor is something different, a new image. So, and these models, so it's a patient tumor that you implant into an immunodeficient animal. The patient tumor in itself costs like 1,200 euro, one single point. And when you use humanized mice, it's another 1,200 euro more. So it's 2,400 a sample. And if you don't know what you do, then obviously it's a big failure. So that's why, and you will see why we have interest in the new instrument. So, but just to tell the story short, initially, we bought the legacy Attune only for counting because we have up to 48 samples of different mice. We can study different experimental groups in one experiment. So it's a lot of samples that we need to characterize initially. And all what we do is actually based on the count of cells that we get from crude extract. Well, initially in the lab, we were using these, maybe you know, these obviously semi-automated slides. And we move away from that because the whole lab was just stopping and for an hour and a half just counting, like, you know, intensely counting. So obviously it was not a good idea. So that's why we changed that. And we went through, we tested several instruments and then we went for the Attune for its capabilities to count very accurately cells into very dilute or crude extract samples. And the way we do it is that we use counting beads. From Thermo, we validate the instrument first with these beads. We make sure like this that the fluidic is stable and everything, that we have the same number of beads each time from a given lot. And once we have done that, we have validated the counting capability of the Attune and the machine is ready for the day. So we have a protocol for that that is, you know, defined for all the organs we are studying. And like this, we are very confident with the results about counting. So why I'm so fun about this is that, you know, in the context of one new preclinical model that we've been approaching in the lab, which is humanized mice, it has shown to be very, very important and actually showing that there was some bias done by others, you know, producing mice in the field. So here I just put you just a chart of what is being done, what we want to achieve there. You basically take super immunodeficient animals, They basically don't have T, B, and NK cells. The macrophage phagocytic capability is not working properly. What you do is then you chemoablate these animals to make space in the bone marrow, and then you inject CD34 human stem cells from the cord blood. And the idea of that is that, you know, over time you will generate a human immune system surrogate into a mouse model. Okay? So it's not completely, I mean, I will be very honest with you, it's not the complete immune system. What works well is B and T cells. And then obviously if you want to have NK cells and all different kind of immune cells, you need cytokines from the human to sustain the growth of these. But in the process of producing these animals that is being done by our partner, one very important thing is that, you know, the graph is stable over, let's say, 12 weeks, but you need to know what is a good mice for models or what is not a good mice. And the way it's being done, you know, historically is that at around 16 weeks post-engraftment, so it takes some time, people do FICOL on mouse blood, and then they evaluate the number of cells that are there, right? Well, the issue with this FICOL approach is that you want here to count the number of human cells, that's correct, but you also have neuron cells, right? And what you want to take or identify is animals that have the top, the best percentage of human cell over mouse cell. And when you do FICOL, you just deplete mouse cells. So you bias your results intensely. And we also seen that we bias the phenotype. Anyway, but beside that, people were not counting. So they just provide a percentage of human cells, you know, which could mean nothing, could be completely wrong. So here just the bias of human CD45 in the FICOL over our approach. And that's why, you know, in the process of helping our partner to optimize their humanization conditions, what has very been key in this experiment was to look at the number of cells that were, you know, circulating in the animals. Because basically there's a, I mean, if you, for example, inject different numbers of CD34 cells, so like 50,000, 75,000 or 100,000 cells, you find out that if you don't inject too much CD34 stem cells at humanization, what you see is that over time, the graft decreases the number of circulating cells. So the quality is not there stable across time. Whereas if you inject 100,000 cells, then you have something stable and for different donors. And this was only possible because we were counting, right? Counting, getting the proportions, everything this in one assay. We could obviously follow with a panel the different types of cells circulating in these animals. Here you have in red B cells and in green T cells over the time of the graft. So you see we followed the animal up to 42 weeks. And we see a trend that has been published already is that over time you see B cell proportion that decrease and T cell proportion that goes up. But just like this, I wanted to highlight you why, you know, the counting capabilities of the Attune is so important to us. So that was one application. The other application that we do very regularly is obviously computing the enrichment yield, because what we want to do in some approach, we obviously want to study tumor infiltrating leukocytes. And these are not the major component of the tumor, right? I mean, it's the tumor cells. So you need to enrich in these cells if you want to immunophenotype them. And basically, we use the Attune to monitor the efficiency of enrichment. Here, it's put an example of a tumor that is a B cell line. So that's why you see lots of CD19 positive cells in the tumor and in the spleen. We basically check the number of cells that are and the proportion of the cells that are present in the samples. Then we compute the number of beads we need to put, and then we do the depletion and monitor the depletion on the tube. And you can see here, we did a good job for this example. So that's another application we do very, very regularly. And obviously then after you can immunophenotype, use different panels, capture different type of populations. So all that is one thing, but then start the problem. So I mean, we are very secure in our field where we look at, you know, organs of lymphoid tissues like spleen, lymph node, bone marrow, thymus. I mean, this is very easy. And then it starts to be complicated when you want to address immune cells in, for example, in the liver, in the brain, or for example, in the pancreas. And then we move out of comfort zone. I would say the next one would be the tumor, obviously, and PDX. But basically, the way we approached the pancreas dissociation was that we got a partners that came to us, wanted to do with us single cell RNA-seq. So we do that in the lab. And they said, you know, our extraction procedure is ready. You know, we just need to sort. So, okay, let's try your approach. They wanted also to sort a kind of tricky cells that are the Schwann cells. And these Schwann cells are actually fibroblastic type of cells, mesenchymal cells, that are there when you have a challenge in the pancreas. What they do is that they change their properties and attract neurons to be able to re-innervate the damaged structure of the pancreas. But basically, when you do the dissociation of the pancreas and you look at the crude extract profile, it looks like this, and it's a mess. So where do you put your forward set scatter? You know, it's very complicated. Obviously, you can have some markers to help you identify a zone, but then, you know, it's very indirect because you need to first gate and then back gate and then identify your subset. So we basically worked a bit with them in the condition, especially for sorting, to clean that that mess a little bit. We used some debris removal solution from different providers. And then you still get, I mean, you get something better, but it's still not optimal, right? And just to make your life even harder, we don't want to study pancreas at the basal state. We want to look at the pancreas in a challenge environment, and it's even more the mess. So it's very difficult to know where to gate and what to take. And because we don't know the sample up front, right? It's like terra incognita, so we really need to understand what we do to find out the right set. So we tested several approaches to remove debris, especially this whack of particles here. But basically, we were never able to get rid of them. Usually, cells of interest are residing here in basal and here in challenge. Anyway, so that's why we actually moved into the CytPix field. So I just put these different here, image of fungi as a metaphor of the different Attune instruments that we got over the time, starting from the legacy to the next V6, and the side piece is like moving to, I mean, to me, it's like moving to an electric engine. So it's really completely, it's another gap into what you can achieve, and I would say very easy to use. So why we move into this? Well, some technicalities. One important thing is that because of the acoustic focusing, you know, it's not completely a stupid idea to mount a microscope on this because it's very sharp and focalized, so it helps in having clear images. And then you have, through the software, you have some abilities to tweak a bit what you can tune the instrument. So you can select what you want to image, the frequency of the image you want to capture. And, I mean, all this will be shown during the workshop, obviously, this afternoon. But so you have some things that you can adjust. But actually, they are very little compared to what you should do, I would say, on a normal microscope. And we will see that this has some impact, but not massive one. And basically, so it's the, you know, first run on the Attune, the different solution that we try to remove, you know, this work of debris. And, you know, in one experiment, we run it on the instrument and we saw it was not debris, right? It was cells, right? Which, you know, obviously is very different because we wanted to really deeply get rid of these guys. And now, it changed the mental perspective. Now we will look for markers to identify these cells and kick them out by magnetic depletion to enrich in our subset. Okay, so it just, you know, for this little history, you see why it's so nice to have image of what you are actually running on the machine. And obviously why we want to better enrich is that we want to keep the sorting time short so that the quality of RNA-seq is better. You know, so it, I mean, it all makes sense in the course of this pipeline. Right, so here is just some nice picture about these particles. So here are our cells of interest. You see how they look, and then that's this type of cells here that are much, I would say, granular and so on. So now let's talk about these camera settings. So you can change a bit focus, to have things clear. And obviously, when you are a newcomer, you don't really know what you do. And one of the fear could be that, you know, with automatic chambers, semi-automated chambers, when you count, you know, you need to make focus. And by experience, that's when people mess up the counting, right? They don't do it, everyone does the same, and then the count is wrong. So I was kind of fearing that we might introduce something bad there. So we looked at this. We had different PBMCs, and then we played around with the different focus time with a setting that we thought were ideal. And then we did several acquisitions and then look at the number of images. So here you have all the run that has been done on the platform. What I forgot to mention is that all this work has been done by a talented scientist in the lab, that is Lilia Agen. So obviously then we combine that with a panel to identify our different cells of interest in different samples. And when we did this and computed the images, so here you have the five donors, you have our ideal settings, then -4, +4 illumination. We also played with the other parameter that is the illumination. So focus and illumination we changed. And you can see that although we change stuff, we get same results. So to me, that means that, you know, you have a comfort zone that you don't need to be expert in focusing yourself, and you will still get good results out of it. And this is, for the different types of cells we looked at, it's working well. Right, and then, you know, it comes with different software. Once you do an image analysis, it will provide some parameters. Obviously, you know, because the cells will go through when it's captured by the microscope, the camera, it could happen that the cell is not completely right in the focus. So you have this capability to remove these marginal events, the ones that stand on the edges. And that's basically using this function. Is on border, you basically then kick out if you have a one, then it's because it's a logic gating. These cells are actually out of the field of view, and basically you cannot capture their properties. The other very important aspect is that you have this particle count, new parameters that is coming. And basically here it shows you that you have either zero, what is zero cells, so it could be debris. Here you would find with one particle your singlets, and with two particles your doublets. So it's quite practical to look on single images for of your sample. And that has been how we approach that initially, is to look whether it was doing a good job, whether when you really count or gate on zero particle, you have no cells. When you got on singlet, on one particle count, you get just singlet, and on two doublets. And basically that's here. Here, the back gating of the samples. You see, when I gate on here, spot count zero, I get this very teeny debris stuff. When I get on one, I have my events nicely on the event gating. Then when I get on two, then it starts to be a bit different, right? I would keep these in my gate originally because there are some of them are falling into my singlet gating. So it tells you that already, you know, the way we do stuff sometimes is not completely appropriate. I mean, obviously here it's not so much a big deal because we did a good job in sample prep, so we have single cells. But when you come to complex tissues, tumors and stuff and blah, and you need to remove doublets and you don't really know how to do it, then it's a different situation. Right. So now, just to show you again that, you know, this debris singlet stuff also is not altered by the changing of focus things. And again, it's like what I showed you with the bar graph before. Whatever we change in terms of condition across the different samples, we had very sharp results. So it's fine. It's robust. That's what I would say. Right. And then now the next part of the talk will be more about, you know, the advanced, I would say advanced neural image parameter. Obviously, maybe I'm not, you know, like Juan, we don't have image cytometry. Actually, I never wanted to go into that field for the reason he mentioned. It's like you get a whack of parameters like 800 and you spend weeks analyzing this. And that's not the purpose of this instrument here, as you understand, because you want to be fast and characterize your sample. So it's a different perspective. Nevertheless, you know, you get, and we heard that yesterday in the audience, we get these new parameters and yeah, what to do with them, you know? And I will need so much time to validate all this, you know, how to handle that. So I took a very agnostic way of analyzing data, so maybe that would help you. We'll see. But just talking about this advance on new derived parameters, when you do your image analysis, you get basically all that out. So there are some parameters that basically are explaining the bright field intensity that you see, some that looks at more how the peaks of signal is distributed with, for example, kurtosis. And skewness as well. You have some that are derived about the area and the perimeter and the shape of the cells. There are some interesting parameters there too that explain the particles that the instrument sees. And basically, it's quite handy how you can access to it once you have analyzed your image. Then you do a right click on your axis, and then you will have down there all these new features that are coming with your sample. Nevertheless, you still need to go through, you know, one by one, and then you just investigate, go back to the image, look. But I did not have this time to do that job, so Lilia did it, but I just wanted to see whether that's, you know, bringing an added value. So I did not go through that route. I did this a bit differently. One of the capabilities that is inbuilt in the software is that you can export an FCS file from the image cells. And you can have, actually, in this export, if you tip this case here, you get an extend FCS file. So what that means is that all these derived parameters that you have access to in the software now are actually enriched in the FCS file at the single cell level. Okay? So that's very handy, because now we can use the FCS file format to approach machine learning algorithms that are being used, like UMAP and stuff. And you can play with single cell features, like with parameter fluorescence. So then I went through my, let's say, proposed gating strategy to analyze the parameters, but what Juan said. So how could we look at this maybe faster? So I just proposed this. So basically here, what you have is here what is not on the field of view, so that's the ones that are, you know, on the edges, and basically here I have the number of particles that are counted, and you can basically nicely gate out, you know, what is empty, gate on singlet, and so on. So I gate in on singlets, and then here what you see as a picture is the number of pixel. And I'm projecting the expression of CD45. So now I have a nice way to get an image that are cells of interest to me. So now if I look at my different patient samples, that's how that looks. So I can do statistics, obviously. I have my percentages, all of this is on image, so just cells that were captured by the microscope. And then I have nicely now my percentage of CD45 cells. And then what I can do in an agnostic manner is look in my plots. So I'm projecting each image parameters as a Z, so in color code, onto forward scatter, side scatter to appreciate a bit what's going on there. I do that here. I just monitor that my gating was correct. But here, that's where I look at the different parameters. And you see that some, you know, don't vary so much from the particular I'm looking at. Remember, I'm looking at PBMC, which is, a rather simple sample. And obviously, some of these parameters might show, must prove to be, to show some heterogeneity when you get to complex tissues. But we see, for example, like kurtosis, that there is something that is being captured there. Eccentricity, major diameter, obviously, cells do not have the same diameter, perimeter, and so on. So we do capture some heterogeneity there. So now, just a short take about this. I mean, it's nothing to do with images, but just, you know, when you start playing with this single site data, one of the very important points is how you scale the data. Because, I mean, in these image parameters, what we get some intensities that are on the attune, you know, in the 10, you know, 10 to the 7, maybe, in values, right? And then you have some others that are in area that are really small. So if you want to use these, and you don't scale properly your data, basically your analysis will be completely driven by the ones that have a very large intensity range. So first thing you need to do is scaling. Here I just put an example of scaling in fluorescence cytometry and why it's so important. It's because when you use algorithm and you do not transform the data, that's what basically the algorithm is seeing, you know, and see no structure. And obviously, I mean, we can use logic or different type of transformation, but so ArcSinus is one being used a lot in our field. But you see, it's not enough. Here, for example, I have positive cells and negative cells. And actually, my negative cells, if I let this transform like this, is split it in two, which is completely wrong. Okay. But if you use that and you feed your algorithm with this, it will be just, you know, stratifying your super negative, your negative positive, and your positive. And then that's the mess. So you also need to have an idea about the cofactor you're using to compress your data nicely around the zero to approach it for this type of analysis. So here it's just one example. If you do a single staining in this dye, so BB700, and you do a T-SNE, for example, here, reduction dimensionality with T-SNE, and you only use this parameter, you omit some other channels. What you might find out, so when I use all marker, it's nicely my nice population of single positives. But when I use everything but my markers, which you might take sometimes, if for example it's a cytokine or an activation marker, you don't want to use it in your dimensionality reduction. Then what we see is these two clouds here. And actually, these two clouds are just the upper and the lower part of the spread of the data. So when the peak is actually being distributed, the algorithm sees that that's one population of cells and that's another population of cells. So when you see this devil horn on your plot, then you better try to understand why. So just to make this aware about this, and what I've been playing there is to find the best transformer for all these parameters so that I can merge them and include them in one analysis. So I did that job already. And you see that, you know, depending on the different parameters I'm looking at, the transform is not the same. So that I bring them all, you know, at least a kind of equivalent to the analysis, that not one will drive the analysis more than the other one. And then I run this unsupervised analysis. So first thing I did is very simple. You do a meta clustering using your fluorescent parameter. You want to find a cluster that is surrogate of a cell type. Then basically here, you can look at the proportion of each of these clusters across your different patients. So I did it very simple, right? So I have CD4, CD8, some B cells, monocyte, and NK cells. Then you can look at this in density plot. Obviously, you have variation patient to patient. And then you can start also doing UMAP, so this dimensionality reduction, by using the fluorescent intensity marker. That's no area, so that's fine. But now you want to integrate the new modality that is image parameter, okay? So if you now do the same type of dimensionality reduction using only image parameters, and I've highlighted the ones that show to be very, very important. Then you reveal now an heterogeneity that you might have missed. So remember that it's only just something we capture through the analysis of the image, or the shape of the cells, the area, the perimeters, but you already see that there is a heterogeneity capture there. Sorry. When I project now each of my metaclusters defined on intensity fluorescent markers, then I can see that for some clusters, you know, they are distributed in some parts of the plots. And then, for example, on this, there are other areas like this one, where I have more orange being actually some T cells. And then here I see I have more pinkish place, which is not true for other area. Just meaning to say that, you know, your population, when you plot them or you project them onto this this UMAP dimensionality reduction, derived on the image parameters, you will find some cells that are in some plots, some area of the plots. So here I'm just looking at the different image parameters, and you see you highlight some areas, you know, some of them like circularity. We have lots of circular cells, but maybe not so much here, right? So these are not circular cells. And then if I look at kurtosis, I see a peak here. But I mean, still it does not mean so, tells me so much yet. Now, obviously you project your markers, you identify your subsets. And now what we can see is that, you know, when I had some cells that were not so circular, they are expressing CD14. So I have some monocytes-ish cells, myeloids, that lose their circularity and that are now captured with this. So, but that's still, you know, you need lots of backdating. You need to use one parameter across and then do the correlation. It takes some time. So I use another trick that is, you know, this idea of doing some categorical analysis using one sense. Basically, what you do here is that you do sequential UMAPs. In one UMAPs, I would use all the image parameters, and on the other UMAPs, I will use the fluorescence intensity parameters. Why I did this? Because I also tried to do a UMAP by using everything, you know, without distinction. And when you do that, the fluorescence intensity markers, they actually take the analysis, so it's not working. You need to separate them into different subsequent analysis. But basically, when you do that, here on this parameter, on UMAP 1, I have image-derived dimension. And on this parameter here, I have fluorescence. So basically, each time I move, you know, from on this axis, I'm changing the cell type I'm looking at. And then each time I move on this axis, then the structure is a bit different from the cells. So if you see now, I'm just focused on the CD4 cells. They are on the bottom here, and we see that from patient to patient, there is heterogeneity that is captured by combining the image and the phenotype. And I can try to understand, you know, what other image parameters are important for this. So here I'm just plotting entropy, area, and so on. But what I wanted to talk about is kurtosis, because that's what is found to be, you know, important in the separation here of the CD4 cells. And kurtosis, I put some explanation about what this is, because I'm sure in the audience nobody knows, maybe one knows and is still, but otherwise nobody. So it's basically talking to you about the shape of your peak, how the signal is integrated. Most of the time we're looking for normal distribution, but it's not the real life. We have some peaks that have a higher frequency of signal centered close to the center of the peak, and some of them when the distribution are more broader. And actually, when you look at this on the image, this is basically the parameter that shows the heterogeneity on the CD4 cell. So that we took from this sample. So what I did is then define two new populations on my CD4, so it's phenotype and image. I boxed the CD4 cells that are kurtosis positive, then got back to the index to identify these cells and look at the image, and that's what you see on the bottom. So here, that's image that are not kurtose, and here image that are defined as kurtose positive. Well, you will say, yeah, but this is nice image, but what does that mean? I don't know. It's just the start. But what I want to say is that with this, you reveal an heterogeneity that might be functionally relevant. Maybe these kurtose cells, you know, they have a metabolic process that is different. And then if I now try to use a metabolic probe, I will be able to highlight something very important about my sample. At least it shows you that with just using image parameters, you can highlight things that you would have missed otherwise. To me, that's a very important message I wanted to bring today. So as take a message, several things. I hope I convince you that, you know, absolute counting is really important, especially for, you know, the immunization condition in these humanized mice that are very expensive. I hope I showed you also that, you know, when it comes to complex tissues, it helps to have images to understand what you do. Having the microscope together with the Attune is very important to describe the sample quality, debris, singlet, doublets, and multiplets, right? But it's not only this. Now with the AI that is inbuilt in the software, you can capture these images and use them for single cell analysis and reveal heterogeneity that you would have missed otherwise by just looking at fluorescent markers. And that when you combine these modalities, it's possible. I told you how to do that today in this talk. So you need to be a bit careful. You cannot use everything in one analysis. You need to think about it in advance. But if you do that properly, then you would reveal some heterogeneity about your sample. And obviously, this is only 2 weeks. You know, it's a very snapshot of experiments. So we will have access to the instrument in June. And here we would run our, you know, most complex sample, the tumor sample, and so on. So you know, stay tuned, and maybe soon we would be able to describe heterogeneity that is functionally relevant using these images on the CytPix. Thank you very much for your attention.